Good evening, everyone. I'd like to welcome you all to the Oxford Area School District Board of Directors Work Session Meeting. Today is October 12th, 2021. It's about 7:05. I apologize for that. I did not realize it was after 7:09. Can we please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance?
Ms. Dean?
Here.
Ms. Harrison?
Here.
Mr. Patterson?
Here.
Mr. Tengett?
Here.
Ms. Warren?
Here.
Mr. Gaspar?
Here.
Mr. Owens?
Here.
Mr. Robinson?
Here.
Mr. Tack?
Here.
All present, we have four.
Approval of the agenda. Agenda, Assistant Superintendent Coles, Mr. Woods.
Thank you, and at your places are a copy of Dr. Margaret Phillips Jones Coles for the school year. Time to discuss some questions you may have on said document.
Anyone have any questions? Okay, moving on. Substitute teacher information, Mr. Ty. I have a question. What am I supposed to say about that?
At your places.
At your places is Chester County District Celebrates?
Yes, those are the.
And now I'll turn it over to Mr. Woods.
Thank you. Those are the Chester County District Celebrates. You can see highlighted in gray or yellow. Our current subrate in the middle of the chart is $105. You'll see that that is somewhat low, except for Adam Grove School District. Now, I have no good authority that Adam Grove School District is going to raise their rate in the coming meetings. However, if you remember, probably about a year ago or less, we discussed substitute teacher rates. And at that time, we were in the ballpark with most of the school districts in Chester County. That has since changed. Many of the school districts have raised their rates, or in some cases, hired full-time substitutes in their school district. What we're seeing is about a 45% fill rate, which is down significantly this year. What I've also seen is a letter, no names, but a letter sent to Substitute Teaching Service, our contractor, that essentially said, I no longer want to work for Oxford because their rate is much lower than X school district's rate or the rate in the state of Maryland. That would be Rising Sun School District. So what I've put together as a proposal, that is in the last gray line on this chart, where we have $130 rather than $105 for a daily rate, up to 10 or more days in a single assignment, meaning the same assignment, then it would increase to $145, up to 20 plus days, a single assignment, and that would have raised to $160. There's also a rate of $175 for days 21 through 89. And the reason that there's not a rate on this chart for Oxford for days 90 through 100 is because at day 90, they go on to the scale B1 or M1 prorated. Again, this is a proposal. This is what I believe is going to allow us, hopefully, to increase that fill rate and and to maintain the substitute teachers that are working locally. I don't know if it's going to increase our sub rate for teachers that would have to drive from, let's say, Westchester or the northern part of the county. But I do know that we have been leading our substitute teaching staff that is willing to work in the Oxford area school district. And also, we have a very difficult time filling the short-term assignments, the less than 90-day assignments. And those assignments are for various reasons. But this, I believe, would at least give us a creative way of maintaining our current base and hopefully adding to people that are going to substitute teach for Oxford area schools. That concludes my explanation. I'm willing to take any questions or any suggestions.
I have a question. You said that the issue was more significant with under 20 days or under 30 days for teaching, for substitute teaching. So is it harder to find substitutes for that?
I don't think I said that. I'm sorry if I misunderstood. I think it's difficult. I know it's difficult to find substitute teachers no matter what. But when they are in those longer assignments, 10 days, 20 days, it's almost like two fronts, really. Longevity increase, and also the expectation is more. Continuity of one teacher in a subject area serves our students better than multiple teachers coming in and out, if that makes sense.
Yeah, so that's why you're raising the rate of the 20 plus more significantly than the other.
That is correct.
What's, have you done analysis of what that's going to increase our cost as a district?
Well, here's my simple analysis. Typically, we have a 75% to 80% fill rate at the current daily rate. Right now we have a 45%. I don't think we're going to break the bank on this is what we anticipate our cost of being. I say anticipate when Mr. Cooney and the Finance Committee and myself set the cost that we anticipate our substitute teacher service to cost us. We're doing it based on a historical average. So obviously we couldn't go back to last year because we weren't open for substitutes to come in the building. So we went back to the prior year. If that makes sense, I don't think we're going to spend any more money in that category. I don't know. Maybe this will work wonderfully. And then we have our staff fully engaged, right? And if so, that would be a good thing. Obviously, it's a target that we use in budgeting, because if we have a high year of absenteeism, it's going to be more. We have a reduced year of absenteeism, we're going to spend less in the substitute teaching category.
So my concern is just that the rate is higher than anyone around us, so for the 20 plus, so, but you think that's necessary to retain the teachers in the area?
I do, and if you look at it, it's not significantly higher, but I do know that districts around us, as I said, Adam Grove, I know is going to increase their rate. What it is, I don't know.
Okay.
But we need some type of attraction. And if that's $5 to $10 a day more, great. But again, this is a proposal. This isn't something that I'm saying you have to do this. I'm open to whatever the board wishes.
Seems like it'd be safer to maybe put that increase to 20 plus. This is my opinion, but slightly lower, because we can always increase it, but we're not gonna really be able to bring it back down again. So when the numbers go back up, we're gonna be paying that long term, so it just seems risky for, when we're already trying to worry about costs in the district.
Can I interject something here? I think the 160 is in the wrong column anyway. At 160, I do believe, Mr. Wood said that was 20 plus, same assignment.
Okay, okay.
So that 160 should actually be over here. And then that means that our 20 plus, if they're just moving around different assignments, is still gonna stay at this 145.
That's correct.
So you're, this is, okay, so shift to the right?
Yes, right.
Oh.
That puts us well in line with everybody else.
Okay, sorry, that's, alright, I think, I'm done.
My other question is, what's the difference between daily and building? I know that we don't have a change in that rate, but that seems to be a significant jump, and I don't know what that difference is.
So, we don't have, that's a building sub, so they're assigned to that building. So that would be, for example, Jordan Bankle.
Means that they go to make a different area.
Correct, they show up there. That's it. I, again, this is Chester County, put these designations, I just dropped some numbers in, apparently one of the wrong column, I apologize.
So then, does that mean to us that if we have a substitute, they're pretty much free to go anywhere in the district? They're like, they can handle that class or whatever?
To a degree, you know, wherever, obviously wherever the opening is, but if we put them in a 20 plus same assignment, that would be same building, same classroom, and then, again, as you look over 21 to 89, that's going to be same subject, same classroom. They're gonna be filling in for that same absent teacher.
One more question, what is TESD?
That would be Tredford East High School District.
That's it for me.
Can you speak to how we would, let, if this proposal goes through, you know, these numbers or different numbers to raise this rate, how we would let the substitutes know that we have done that, and in particular, the ones who are passing. I'm assuming that the service that we need is not probably listed, but those other subs we might see that.
So we would contact substitute teacher service and tell them to advertise this to all of their people, especially the ones that most recently dropped off the Oxford list. So they would, they have the software that they can do that, and they can do a reach out, mass reach out to those individuals.
Any other questions?
Do we know, to say, us or Matt, or both the $200 for itself, do we know if the amount of funding that goes to the sub is the same for both districts? Or is there variation even though we're paying the same total amount? I'm just curious on if we up this, is the same amount of money gonna go to the, you know, to the subs as the other groups, or is this just gonna be additional funding for whoever our supplier is?
So let me answer your question this way. The dollars that you see here going to that individual substitute. What you're not seeing is the percentage that the substitute teacher service makes off of this. So there would be an increase in substitute teacher service because they're at a flat percentage of the daily cost. And as far as other districts, president was to put it on the agenda, and then in fact, we put it on the agenda.
What if it doesn't go on the agenda?
The rates stay the same.
I'd like to see this on the agenda. Is there any, anybody wanna follow me on that?
I'll follow you on that.
Anybody else? Okay. So, I guess Mr. Cooney will be putting this on the agenda the next week? Any other questions on this? Regular meeting agenda. Did anyone see anything on the regular meeting agenda that, sparked any questions or concerns? It looks, pretty meat and potatoes to me is what we're usually used to, so I didn't see anything crazy on here. Where do we actually stand? Is there gonna be a mandate for vaccines? Is that headed all the way?
I have subject? I have no idea. It would be off subject, but I have no clue.
Alright.
Mr. Frye, I do have a question about next week's, agenda.
Okay.
Regarding the, closing item correspondence, so this particular letter does not follow, our policy 950, which is, regular business meeting correspondence, because it does not include a name and address for township. So I was just wondering if there was one keep it there, if there have been other correspondence that does not.
Yeah, and, I appreciate that. You are correct. It does not have those. It has a national, affiliation statement, and as it's addressed to the board and myself, I made sure to put it on as correspondence, but if the board wishes, they can certainly remove it as correspondence.
I would like that removed.
Move it.
Any other concerns about the regular meeting? The regular meeting agenda?
No, I didn't see this one there, so I don't know what we're going to do with this, but I have a question about.
Is that what we discussed before?
Margaret? No. Margaret, Chair of the Board, and the Council of the Department of Education.
Do we have a copy of that here?
Yeah, the, assessment question.
Nah. Yeah, well, go ahead and address that, would you please?
Do you mind if I ask you a few questions about you? I'm not sure about the answers, but, it says in here that it's mandated that we have to participate in this, and that there's testing, dates. And it looks like it's assessments. My question is, we're already doing these with the children, correct? Assessments and so forth?
That's that is not the, that's marked as an assessment of forms, there's rules for civics and, US history.
Okay, I see math, history, civics, reading.
Yeah, we kind of selected for eighth grade. We participated in the past with the fourth grade, because we did math and reading, but the eighth grade is civics and US history.
So is there anything here that we're not already capturing that we can provide them and not have to put the kids through additional testing? I mean, and we test them to death as it is.
I understand, but that is the requirements that we can see, and it is in US history and civics, which we do not have an eighth grade, US history and civics. We do have benchmarks in history, not specifically in the format of your.
So they want to test on things that we're not testing on? Is that correct? have a benchmark.
We have benchmarks.
Okay. And that's not acceptable to them, to give them that? And how long is this testing, additional testing?
We'll be on 3/3/2022, March 3rd. And that one page, you can see the second page there, it says the date. That's where it says 3/3/2022. Just a plain piece of paper with one, maybe that could give you a different sheet. And then I'll be on, here is the law, like.
Okay.
So we only need for our grade 8. We have not been selected for grade 4, we have been selected for grade 8.
So it's just for the grade 8? And it's just for those two, the history and civics?
Yes.
And it's 2 days?
It's one day.
One day?
March 3rd.
Okay.
And the reason why I put it into the presentation, the PowerPoint, obviously the board approved the assessment calendar, and we provided that at the last meeting, the assessment calendar. This would be added to our assessment calendar.
And do parents still have the option to opt out on this as they do with our other testing?
Absolutely, we have to opt out.
Okay.
How do we advertise that? I mean, most of the time, when I have kids in this district, and I didn't know what they were doing until they'd already done it.
Yeah, well, we'll be sending a letter home that we've been selected. The principal will be sending a letter, we've been selected to participate in this testing, which requires testing. And in the day of the time. And then we'll also post it on our assessment calendar, which is already posted, so that we notify after our meeting next week. Assessment calendar, department's calendar, that's that one, like, they have.
Great, thank you, Dr. Jones.
Do we know what the selection criteria was that was used to add Oxford to this?
I do not know why our 8th grade was selected. I think they rotate them, and through state. But I can certainly find that information for you.
Okay, I'd be curious to know what other schools around us have been chosen as well for this.
I'd be happy to find that.
Thank you.
Do you know what they're gonna be doing with the results of this?
Now, we use that to determine the progress across the state with the results. And we will ask for the, because it's anonymous, we'll be asking for the results that presented to our state. So we'll ask for the data.
But you don't know what they'll do with the data, what their plan would be? Do you think they have a plan if they took all this time and money to test them?
I'm sure they'll be at how well they're instructing civics and English.
Any other questions about the upcoming regular meeting agenda? Okay, calendar. Before I start, do we have any additions to the existing calendar? Good. It looks as though every one of these is gonna be still here in Hopewell Auditorium, is that correct, for the next one? I like it, we're good here. It's in a tassel for the people here. Okay. Let's plan on doing that again, if that would. Over one more meeting here, and then we'll move back. Is that gonna be okay with you? Something. Right.
So what, one more meeting here?
Remember that, yeah. Good. Alright, so the remaining October meetings, the policy committee meeting at 6 p.m. will be here in Hopewell. Budget finance committee meeting will be October 19th, 6:30 p.m. here at Hopewell. The October 19th regular meeting at 7 p.m. will be here at Hopewell. Then beginning November 9th, the Athletic and Student Activities Committee at 6:30, and the Facilities and Safety Committee at 6:45, and the work session at 7 p.m. will all be at the admin building. 25 Bell Tower Road. November 16th, regular meeting at the admin building. And then December 7th, the reorganization meeting at 7 p.m. at the admin building. I'd like to take time now to recognize any visitors or speak for the board.
Good evening, Doris Lager, Oxford. I have a huge problem with last month's meeting. Last month's meeting did not look very good sitting in the audience. It seemed like there was a couple of people who made a decision for the many of you. And it seemed that some of you were a little, you really didn't know what was going on. Things were put on the agenda in the wrong place. Things weren't written right. It seemed like there was something going on that was a little nefarious. And I would like to know if anything's been done about that. Has anybody investigated what happened? No. Okay.
So I will tell you that I went back and I looked at, because the meetings are recorded and they're available online for you to view. And I did go back and I looked at the work session, so the meeting that was held before the meeting was available. And I listened to the wording that was requested to be put on the agenda for us to vote on.
Okay.
And what I heard being requested to be put on the agenda for us to vote on was almost word for word what was on the agenda for us to vote on the following week.
Okay, but what about it being put in the wrong spot?
I don't understand what you mean about it being put in the wrong spot. So I cannot answer that one. The wording to me seemed to be very similar to, I believe it was Mrs. Mead who actually was asking.
So then what exactly was the mix-up and what was the reason why?
I don't know.
You don't know?
I don't remember there being a mix-up. I mean, I do remember there being Mr. Patterson not liking the word, but that's why I went back and I looked at it. But I don't understand the mix-up of it not being the place where it was supposed to be or something like that.
Okay. All right. Well, after meeting last month, I asked your attorney if I could speak to him in a couple of minutes. And he told me, to my face, I do not work for you, I don't have to speak to you, I work for them. And I said, so you're refusing to talk to me? And he said, yes, I do not work for you. And I thought that was a little rude. And I thought, well, what do you have to hide? If, you know, you can't talk to me for a couple of minutes. But I've been watching a lot of meetings of a lot of school boards all around the country, and I can tell you, your attorney is not working for you. He is not working for you. He has his own agenda. And maybe a few of you have the same agenda as the attorney. I don't know. But I do know that you're worried about money for this and doing that. What are you going to do when people start taking their kids out of the school and not bringing them back? We have no flights because there's no pilots and there's no stewardess, because people don't want these mandates. We are losing our cops, we are losing our firefighters, we are losing our doctors, and we are losing our nurses. Everybody's walking out because of stupid mandates. And all across the country, I see these people standing up and saying, you know what, a mandate is not a law, we're gonna do what we wanna do and let the parents have the decision. And you guys just don't even really seem to get much. So you don't care if next year you have kids that you have this year? What happens when the mandates, because Wolf said this, this himself. The masks will not stop until everybody is vaccinated. Do you really think that's gonna happen? Because I would kill somebody before I let them vaccinate my granddaughter. And that is the honest to God truth. Children are dying. Children are having seizures. They're getting myocarditis. I know you're tired of hearing about the masks, but you know what? I'm tired of talking about it. I am tired of your attorney not working to do what he should be doing to get you some kind of results. There are other school districts that are in states just like ours, okay? And they are just saying no. They're just saying no. There are other school districts who have just said no. And guess what's happening to them? Nothing. Nothing is happening to them. The state education department said that they do not track compliance with state mask orders. The sheriffs have all said that they are not going to go after anybody who do anything about it. Just wait for that, aren't you? There's going to be a major, major problem with this school district. There's going to be a major, major problem because people are talking about taking their children out and taking them to other schools and taking them to teachers who will homeschool them in their own homes. You all have a wonderful morning.
I want the board to stand up. I want them to
and you're not hearing us. And I feel that's very unfortunate. You are listening to your solicitor, your lawyer, who is intimidating you. You're listening to the Pennsylvania Department of Education, who is intimidating you. But you're not listening to the people who are here that are actually part of the community that have children in this school district. Stand up for our children. Please, all of you. You have a responsibility.
They are, yes.
Okay, what is the increase from September 2009 to now, the number of violent acts in our schools?
I have no idea. It's a yearly report, so it's kept within the school year. As you're saying, September to end of June, and that's all published online.
Who is it on?
Should be on the State Department of Education's website. That is correct.
Anyone else for Justice Wood? Adjournment, do I have a motion to adjourn? Second. Any adjournment?